Hello, everybody, wherever you may be, from coast to coast and sea to shining sea, want to welcome you back to Ham Radio Live, a show about radio for people who love radio. Today, we're going down south. I mean real down south. All the way to Antarctica. We're going to talk about ham radio in Antarctica, one of the most inhospitable places on Earth. Strap up them seatbelts. Hold on tight. It's Ham Radio Live.
Young man, there's no need to feel down. I said, young man. Yourself off the ground, I said, young man, 'cause you're in a new town. There's no need to be unhappy, young man. There's a place you can go, I said, young man, when you're short on your dough.
Wow. You know, when you think of the term disco, right? This is the one song most people will say is disco. And it really shot up the charts. Biggest hit by the Village People to this day. Great song. In fact, still very listenable after all these years. Can you believe it? YMCA. Came off their initial album along with In the Navy and a whole bunch more. Let's take one more listen to the chorus and make sure you're doing the exercises. Ready? Away we go.
It's fun to stay at the YMCA. It's fun to stay at the YMCA. They have everything for your men to enjoy. You can hang out with all the boys. It's fun to stay at the YMCA.
From the four winds of the world, wherever you may be, we're going way down south today in Antarctica. From wherever you are in the world, thank you for coming to Ham Radio Live. Away we go, everybody. Happy Tuesday. It feels so good to have this face back again. Doesn't look great, but we got no more bandage on it, and that's a pretty cool thing. Folks, the reason we come and have a bunch of fun with you every day is to try and encourage people, even if it's just one, to get their ham radio license or to license up. That's a big deal to me. It really is. Licensing up is huge. Contact someone like the Radio Society of Great Britain. Wonderful group, and they'll help you get your ham radio license. Hit the contact us bar, www.rsgb.org. They'll send you a ham radio club that's close to you, and then you get to know the club and learn ham radio. They're a good group. www.rsgb.org. If you'd like to join them, by the way, you could do so at www.rsgb.org/join. If you'd like to email the show, please reach out to me at cqhamradiolive@gmail.com. Unfortunately, my phone is broken right now.
No!
Yeah, and it's really bad. It will not charge up. I can't get it to recharge. So I've got a 2 o'clock appointment, which is like an hour and a half away to get the doggone thing fixed. And hopefully we'll have a real phone. I'll be able to check messages again. So sorry if you've written me and you've sent me something. I'm sorry, I don't have it right now. I know Rod sent me a neat picture, which I'll share with you tomorrow on the show. First one up today, Andy Cowley out of the UK. He's our first one. Welcome, Andy. Good to see you. First guy to make it in. Welcome. 2 Echo 0, Romeo Echo Echo. Thanks for being here, mate. Steve from the UK. That's 2 for 2 from the UK. Mike 7, India Whiskey Hotel. 3 for 3, UK. Mike 0, Oscar Papa X-Ray. And then John Hummel Newell from Canada made it North America's way. Good job, mate. Victor Echo 5, Juliet Hotel, November. Hello, John. Nice to see you. Rod Clare is here from Salem, Oregon. Kilo 7, Lima Alpha Papa. Kilo 7, Victor Foxtrot Oscar. Welcome back. Coolest call sign in history. I love that. David is here. Hi, Dave. Alpha Echo 0, Papa Hotel. Anton from Holland, Papa Charlie 4 Alpha Delta, YMCA. Yes, we did it. That was fun. That was a fun intro. I love that song. It's good to see you guys. Sky Flyer's back. Welcome, my friend. It's nice to see you. You know, he just got his full license in the UK. He just did last week. Congrats again, mate. Good work. Seriously. Well done. New full licensing in the UK. I don't forget that stuff. That's important to me. Alan Webb, good evening to you all the way in the UK. 2 Echo 1, Hotel Quebec Zulu. Alan, you're a first-timer. Welcome to Ham Radio Live. Nice to have you today. It's Tell Me Something Good Tuesday, by the way. You guys tell me something that could be good, bad, indifferent about ham radio. It's all your stuff. You get to talk whatever. Bass is here. Good evening, everybody, and hello to you as well. Thank you for coming. In fact, the YMCA song came from the birth year of him. His first year, yeah, 1978. Wow. I'm feeling really old here now. I feel very old. Hi, Greg. Bettendorf, Iowa is in the house. Kilo Fox Zero, Charlie Union Zulu. I hope the weather is warming up a little bit at least. I hope so, Greg. Good to see you. Thanks for coming today. Andy New, Mike Seven, Charlie Union November. Welcome back, mate. Good to see you. Thanks for coming. Steve, thank you. It's still really swollen, looks kind of crummy, but better than before. It's tough when you got a giant bandage on your face. By the way, let's do live YouTube. Woohoo! Thank you. Thank you very, very much. And, you know, we'll get into something in a second I want to say before we start the show. Ron Walensky's here. Hi, Ron. Happy Tuesday to you, my friend. November 8, Whiskey Charlie Romeo. It's nice to have you. And Rod makes it nice here. He said, license up, you can do it. That's really a big deal. To me, it is. Please do that. Study for your next license level. Work hard. Even if you fail it, still work hard to still license up. When you do, the feeling is, it's indescribable. It really is. And you can do it. Don't think it's too hard. You can do it. Uncle Harold joins us from a very cold Canada right now. He says, hello, friends. Looking forward to the show. A good shot of energy in the middle of this gray afternoon. Looking good, Larry. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's very nice. Very nice. Alan Webb, that's another first-timer. No, that's, you know, again, sorry, 2 Echo 1 Hotel Quebec Zulu. Welcome back. It's nice to have you again, Alan. Thanks for being here. My brother Bob Kersey, WIFI, and more than that, it was Bob's phone that allowed me to make the show today. It seriously is. My phone's, like, gone. It just stopped charging yesterday afternoon. I'm like, oh, no. There's, like, 10%. Because, you know, that phone tells you, like, it's, like, 20%, 10%. You're like, oh, gosh. Okay, plug it in. And it won't charge. And I'm like, what the heck? I go through three different cords, you know, to recharge it. We'll still not do it. And finally, it just went, and I'm lost my phone. So it's like, I do not know what happened, but we'll get it fixed later after the show. Indy's back from the VK lands, and I mean VK lands. This man's a truck driver, and he travels all through Australia, all throughout South Australia. I would love to be a passenger with him. It'd be a lot of fun. He says, good day, Lair. Sorry I've been elsewhere, LOL, mostly out in the boondocks, listening and no typing per usual. Well done. Indy, welcome from Australia. It's nice to have you. It's an honor that you're here. A dear friend, Whiskey 6, Julia, India Mike, that's Jim from Walnut Creek, California. Jim, thank you for coming this afternoon. It's good to see you. Mike Oswald from the state of Washington, Alfalfa Mike 7, Mike Oscar from Kirkland, just had a QSO with New Zealand on 15 meters. There it is. Yep, it's good conditions today. And Andy, thank you. Bandage free, Larry. I'm so happy. The best part was I could take the shower. That was like a moment for me. It was like, oh my gosh, here I am. And I'm like, I finally get to go and take a shower. It was amazingly fun. Yeah. It was a long one too, believe me. My gosh. Okay, first of all, before we start, I want to make a little correction to yesterday. And it's important too. I don't want to put people down for radios. That's not me. And it came across that way yesterday. And I didn't like that. First of all, Zygu. Let me just say this clearly, okay? It's not my favorite radio, but it's a great radio. If you're working portable, excellent. The thing will tune a salad fork for an antenna, for goodness sakes. It's a fantastic radio for a lot of people. It depends on your needs, right? You do a lot of outdoor stuff, portable stuff. You don't need much more, right? It's a really good radio for that. Now, the 6100, take a look at the EHAM reviews. That'll give you a good idea of why I said what I said yesterday. It just comes from people's use of it. Now, does that mean you'll have the same issues? No, but take a look at what else you can buy and your future for ham radio, right? If you're planning to maybe go up from from Foundation Intermediate in the UK, you're going to want a radio that already has 100 watts, right? So think the future. That's all. It's a fine radio. It really is. But do think about where you want to go, because I don't want you to waste a lot of money like I did, okay? I'm trying to make you learn a little bit from Larry's experience. Yeah. And you guys, trust me, believe me, I admire people who do things. In fact, we show Kevin today from Iowa using the Zygu G90. no kidding, using a church bell for an antenna.
Yeah.
Just did it. Just did the video. He sent it to me. It's good stuff. So folks as I do, they're great radios. They do amazing stuff. And the QRP calls they make are phenomenal on the G90s. Jeez, they're phenomenal. So again, please don't take what I said wrong. Just make good decisions. Think about your future. Think about where you want to go. Don't waste a lot of money like Larry did. Just that public service announcement presented by Larry. Whew. Roger McKeon, welcome back. Oh my gosh, I didn't turn Roger off. That's good. Kilo Juliet 7, Lima X-ray. Hi, Roger. Good afternoon to you. Thanks for coming. Ian's here from Holland, Papa Alpha Zero, Romeo November Hotel. Ian, good evening, mate. Nice to see you. Thank you for coming tonight. It's great to see you. Really is. Cloud Dumper, he says, G-O-F-A-E, love the show. Bless your heart. Thank you, mate. That's really nice. I felt bad about yesterday's show, guys. I did. I do. I feel bad. I don't mean to offend or hurt anybody. I never do. Really. Your radio is your radio. Enjoy it. Have fun with it. Not everybody likes my radios. That's okay. I just, you know, I want you to learn from the experience of someone who has spent money and lost money on radios. That's all. Okay. Indy, I'll send you a clip now radio-related privately that'll give you a little more insight of traveling the outback in Australia. We'll take it. Kel's here from Norway, Lima Bravo Zero, Yankee India. Thank you for coming. We're going to have a fun show today. Let's get into the show. By the way, today is a good day because it's Tell Me Something Good Tuesday. Yep. Tell me something good about your radio or something that you're frustrated with or maybe something you're struggling with radio today. You're part of the comments. It's your show. Let's have fun today on Ham Radio Live. Okay. Your Ham Radio forecast today, powered by ICOM. ICOM for the love of ham and shortwave. Look at all the sunspots on this. A1A. It looks nice, doesn't it? Here is the coronal home map. 56 and 55 look like angry devils, but we'll see what happens. K-index, low. K1 finally. This has taken a week for our K indexes to come down. So that means quiet conditions on the lower bands, 160, 80, 75, and 40. They'll be quieter today. Look at the solar flares. I was going to use an earlier one, but then look what happened. M1.3 just about an hour or so ago. We'll see if this affects our ionosphere here later this week. If it does, it's going to happen sometime on Friday. Okay, so that would be when the impact from that M1.3 flare hits. Current conditions out of Boulder, SFI 107, solar number up to 72, A index is 8, K is 0. Isn't that beautiful? Positive BZ latitude of 0.2, solar wind 384.8 kilometers per second. And you can see the HF conditions there. Plus, moon bouncers have fair chance to work the moon tonight. This is a wonderful day to use your ham or shortwave radio. Here's the current MUF map, Kilo Charlie 2 Golf. Literally, I mean, you can work 10 meters from Canada, from most of Canada all the way to South America, and you'll work it into the Pacific, certainly into Tahiti. You could probably go as far as Tahiti, but certainly, you know, you've got Hawaii and you've got a lot of islands in the middle of the Pacific you could hit as well. On the upper bands, we're talking 15, 12, and 10 meters. They're beautiful right now. If you're in Europe, you've definitely got 40 and 80, and it's a beautiful night to work your radio. Low noise floors. That's the main thing. Low noise floors help you hear far away DX. Yeah. So folks all the way from Ireland, all the way to Tokyo, you're going to be able to hear each other on 40 and 80. Down into Indonesia, even into Western Australia, Perth, you've got a great pipeline tonight. Use it in Europe, please. Ham and shortwave forecast for today. Voice bands throughout the world, 20, 17, 15, 12, and 10. CB radio, folks, you'll have good conditions today all the way north, mid, and south latitudes. Data 30 to 10, all latitudes are open. Nighttime ham band openings tonight, which is beautiful because the K index is down to 0. It's a wonderful night to use your radio. 160, 80, 75, 60, 40, 30. Best DX in the north is on 80 and 40, 20 in the south. But remember, work your MUF at sunset. Okay, sunset MUF, sunrise 40 meters is always your best bet because the D layer hasn't started yet, right? And you can start making some great calls to the west of you. So remember, 40 at sunrise, MUF at sunset. Shortwave band daytime, 31. 25, 22, and 19. Shortwave bands open tonight, 120, 90, 75, 60, 49, 41, 31, 25, 22, and 100% chance of the 19-meter band open in the southern hemisphere for about an hour after sunset, and your signals will fade away. Remember, today is Tell Me Something Good Tuesday. Tell me something about ham radio. We will work it into the show today, and a very happy Tuesday to you around the world today. Well, welcome, Scott, my mate from Colorado. A very happy afternoon to you, my friend. Rod Clare out of Oregon. I can't wait to get out of the trailer with the G90. It is, you know, that's a great rig to take out with you. If you're going to be portable, the thing tunes a solid fork. I mean, you can tune anything. Kevin's going to show us that today on the show, by the way. Kilo Zero, Kilo Lima, Bravo. You're going to love this segment. He did a lot of work into it, and he is the G90. It's a really, really neat video. I want to welcome Kel from Norway. Thank you for coming. Lima, Bravo, Zero, Yankee, India from Norway. Thank you for coming. Martin is here from Holland. Pop Echo 9, Tango India Golf. And Martin was the one I talked about yesterday who talked about growing old with your radio. He really lived that life, and I admire him for that. His call sign again, Pop Echo 9, Tango India Golf. He says, here, live in the shack with all of you. Martin, welcome to the show. Nice to have you. Mike in Kirkland says, the New Zealand station was ZL1. X-Ray Romeo is still on the air. Folks, if you're here in North America, take a listen. 21.383. She's a DX Commander Classic antenna. Wonderful, wonderful stick. Coming to the show this Saturday, Jeff Doran, November Juliet 2, Union Sierra, talks to us about working portable. Not really. He's going to talk to us about something else. He's going to talk to us about working with a great receive antenna. Yep. And I said portable just by mistake because we were working with Charlie so much. And Charlie, what a nice guy. November Juliet 7 Victor out of Red Summit in Arizona. That was a great show. Really was. Jeff's going to be here this Saturday to talk about using beverage antennas. Yep, you can hear better. You can hear a lot better using a beverage. In fact, the world just opens up for you either on ham or shortwave bands. They really do. Even AM. Yeah, folks that like to DX AM. If a beverage antenna, man, if you have the space, this is a way to use it. He's going to explain exactly how to build it and how to do it this Saturday, 20 UTC. That's 8 p.m. London. That's 3 p.m. in the Eastern Time Zone of North America, noon Pacific, and 7 a.m. in Western Australia. The following weekend, Tom Pollard, Alpha Echo 1, Tango Papa, Alpha 9-2 Golf Whiskey, comes in to talk about using an affordable, adjustable whip antenna to make some transcontinental contacts. You'll want to be here for that show. That's coming up Saturday, February 26th at 20 UTC. The following Saturday, the Smokin' Ape comes. Yep, we'll talk about antennas, YouTube, and ham radio. You're going to love that. You can ask him any question you want to, and the ape will be here to answer it. 20 UTC. Good show. That'll be a good show. Then on the 26th of March, Kevin, who we're going to have a little short clip from, working, believe it or not, a church bell as an antenna. No kidding. Kilo Zero, Kilo Lima Bravo joins us from a cold Iowa, 20 UTC. He'll talk QRP as well as using unconventional antennas to make calls. Then a brand new one, Anthony Lucer, Kilo 8 Zulu Tango. He's done an incredible amount of research. In fact, a wonderful, wonderful article on all bands. It's a publication of DX Engineering where he wrote an article about FT8 and how it has totally taken over digital and how popular it is with young hams. Please join us for that show. That's Saturday, March 19th at 20 UTC. You're absolutely going to love meeting Anthony. He's a really humble guy and a kind dude, too. All right, we're going to change slides.
K0KLB, K0KLB.
Remember we showed you this yesterday with Kev?
November.
Remember that? Okay, so we're going to show you something different today. Kevin was here yesterday, and he sent me this morning, and through the magic of my brother's phone, here's Kevin using something a little different this time as an antenna. Find it on his YouTube channel at Kilo Zero, Kilo Lima Bravo.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back. Out here this morning for random metal objects on the air, we're going to try and see what this old church bell will do for as an antenna. Now, it's minus 6 degrees out here this morning. I've got a little bit of a breeze, so it's tolerable, but we're going to get the clam ham shack out, set up here, and see what we can do. Now, this old bell came out of our old church that was built in 1920. and hang on a second, 1920, and it was replaced by a new church in the 70s. So the new church got a new bell, so we brought the old bell out here and put it on the farm. And every morning I open up the shade from the house, look out the window and see that and wonder how that would act as an antenna. So today we're going to find out. Now you and I both know, you know, it ain't going to work. This thing will not radiate and we're not going to make any calls. But you know what? We won't know until we try and find out. So let's see what we can do. Come on, let's go. Well, here's the setup. We got the clam ham shack right here. And we've got a single wire coming from the tuner, coming right out here. And I just got it alligator clipped right there. I tried to shine up some of that rust, but I don't know. All right, that bell is 46 inch bell. So it's 46 inches in diameter. And I also did run a counterpoise ground off the tuner back here, off the back side. So we'll see how this works. Let's go inside here. It doesn't take long for the old hands to get cold at minus 6 degrees. Look. Here's the setup. We got the radio set up here on a table. Got me a couple chairs. And close up the door there a little bit. We got our little Mr. Buddy heater going to keep us nice and toasty in here. And it is toasty in here. On the radio setup, we got the Zygu G90 connected with coax to my tuner. It's the MFJ971 QRP tuner. And on the back side here, we got my single wire over here going up and outside to the bell. And I've got my counterpoise connected right there going out to the back side. Let's see if we can tune this thing up. Okay, we're gonna put on a 5-watt carrier and see how we tune up. Looks like we're about a 1.2:1 SWR. I think we'll roll with that.
And now keep in mind, Kevin is simply seeing if a simple church CQ, bell CQ, will work or not.
Zero, Kilo Lima Bravo, calling CQ, CQ, CQ. This is Kilo Zero.
And it's below zero.
Well, so far we haven't had much luck. Signals coming into me are pretty weak, and I'm sure nobody's hearing me very well. I'm going to go out and make a modification that I think might help a little. Let's go.
Now keep in mind, it's like below zero, but he's still trying.
And when I put this clamp down here on the metal, it's so rusty, I don't think I was getting to any shiny metal. I tried as much as I could, but I grabbed this vice grip and got clamped down tight, and I wrenched on it to get down to some shiny metal now. So I'm making it good metal to metal and got past the rust. And then I clamped my alligator clip right to the vice grip. And we're gonna make some calls and try that, see if that helps us at all.
QRZ, this is Kilo 1, Delta Delta November, Omus Kiso Party.
Kilo 0, Kilo Lima Bravo.
Kilo Lima Bravo.
Oh, Kilo 0, Kilo Lima Bravo, QSL?
QSL, Kilo 0, Kima, I can see that. Kilo 0, Kilo Lima Bravo. Kevin, you're 5555 here into Colorado.
Well, thank you. You're my first contact. You're 5-7 into Iowa.
Kilo 0, Kilo Lima Bravo, you're 5-6 into Kentucky. Parking 1251
QSL, Kevin. I got you 2-2, Kevin. 2-2, Connecticut.
That's Kilo Zero, Kilo Lima, Bravo, 4-4, New Jersey. QSL.
Well, there you have it. We made four good calls. 20 meters, we made two calls to Colorado and Kentucky. And on 17 meters, we made two calls to Connecticut and New Jersey. All in all, it was a pretty big struggle all day to make some contacts. Nobody was hearing me, and the stations I heard were pretty light. So it was the strong stations that I could hear that I was able to make contacts with. I'm assuming it's probably because they had some pretty good antennas that they were listening on. So anyway, we had a good time. And you know, in an emergency situation, I probably wouldn't recommend an old church bell, but you know, it did work. So in a big emergency, it might work for you. Otherwise, we had a good time. I think it finally warmed up to about zero, and the buddy heater's out of gas, so we're ready to pack up and head out. Thanks for joining. I appreciate you coming and watching. And we'll see you next time, 7-3.
Look at those QSOs. G90 with a church bell. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Well done, Kev. Well done, Kevin. That's great work right there. Look at that. Kevin is so ingenious. He just finds things like silos and tractors and now a church bell to be able to make calls on. It's unbelievable. On his IQ G90, Kev, I'm proud of you. Well done. Good video. Find him here on YouTube. Kilo Zero, Kilo Lima Bravo. He's a talented guy. Put a lot of work into that that show, too. Folks, if you'd like to send me some of your work or maybe a picture of your shack, your QTH, your antennas, please feel free. We'll make it part of the show. Get ready at CQ, hamradiolive@gmail.com, and we will make sure that you're part of what we're doing. What'd you guys think of the video up there in the crow's nest?
Yeah, you never know when something funny is going to happen on this show.
Did something funny happen?
Yeah.
You'd never know it.
Air trivia today. Okay. North America behind by 570 to 75. The world is leading North America right now in the middle of the month, and we'll see what you get today. What's the purpose of a Smith chart? Now, this is on the U.S. Amateur Extra Test. This is where you get the Smith chart stuff, okay? So what is the purpose of a Smith chart? Is it A, determine impedance and admittance, B, determine propagation, MUF, C, calculation of current density, or D, determining radial spread, okay? Smith chart, what's the purpose of it? A, determine impedance and admittance, B, determine propagation and MUF, C, calculation of current density, or D, determining radial spread. Let me know with A, B, C, or D. I'll give you a hint. There it is. Let me know your answer, and we'll make it part of the show today. All right, we'll see who catches up or who takes the lead. First one to my computer on this end, Rod Claire from Salem, Oregon, determines impedance and admittance, and he got it right. First one. That's good. North America now ties the game at 75. Yep. It does determine impedance and admittance. This is what we did before we had antenna analyzers, really. This is about it, okay? It'll tell you resistance right along the horizontal axis, and then it has positive reactance, which is inductance, and negative reactance, which is capacitance. So it'll help you calculate all three with a Smith chart. Again, this is going to be found on your amateur extra test. So learn about Smith charts and what they do, even though we really use antenna analyzers to do that stuff today. All right, let's get caught up. And before we get trivia question number two, because I do want to welcome some folks, VK Radio Ham joins us all the way from Australia. That's Jerome from the Victoria, that'd be Victoria, right? The area around Victoria in Australia. Mates, good to see you, Jerome. Thanks for coming today. Nice to have you as always. Always good to have you. Thank you. Yeah, and I told, you know, it's funny. Steve says, great pop-up shack, right? I told him he should call it, what do you think? I think he should call it the clam shack because it's a clamshell, you know. Maybe not. Okay. Andy New doesn't need a radio. The bell makes its own QSL cars. That's great. That might be the comment of the show, Andy. The bell does it all. It's great. Roger McKeon makes it right. Yeah, the Midwest ingenuity right there. We just make it work. And speaking of that, what's coming up from Antarctica, you're going to love, because they really have to make things work down there because there's no stores. There's nothing you can buy stuff for. You have to use what you have to make things work. I hope you like the segment about working ham radio all the way from Antarctica. Rod Bish, welcome. Whiskey 3 Mike Papa Golf. Poda on a church bell. That's awesome. Yes, sir. It's on Kevin's channel. He's amazing. Steve with a neat comment. Imagine if it's up on top of the bell tower, how well it would do. That's an interesting point. Kevin, November 4, Papa Oscar Delta. That means Tennessee, Eastern to be specific, is here. Jeff, welcome. Thanks for coming. Also answering the last trivia question about the Smith chart right here was Anton, who just missed it. Literally, he came in right a split second after Rod did. He had A. Steve in the UK had A. Jeff had A in Tennessee. David had A. Roger with A. Andy with C. Andy Cowley with C. Rod with D. Ron with A. And I think we're good. We got everybody caught up. Also, welcome to William. He's in Jacksonville. I got a new call saying, good afternoon, Larry and chat. New call, November 5, Echo Victor Victor. Congrats, William. That's great. That's great. It's neat to celebrate that stuff, isn't it? That's why I love celebrating when you guys achieve up, when you get a good call sign. Really, when you get up in class, let me know, because we're going to celebrate that on the show. By the way, today's a special day. I don't think he's here, but he'll maybe watch on replay. Today is Ishmael from Dominica's 18th birthday. For Ish, here you go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you.
18 years old today. Keep getting them, Ish. You're doing great in ham radio. We're really proud of you here on the channel. So thanks for what you do. Street News Now is in the shack. It's good to have you. Oh, my gosh. That's a great T-shirt. The Loop was a great FM station. I worked in Chicago radio in the late 70s, 80s at WGCI-FM and WBMX-FM. Yes, sir. And good stations there, too. Good stuff. Isn't it fun? Radio, and see, he would know. Radio, commercial radio has changed so much since what it used to be. It used to be personality driven, right? The personalities drove your ratings, right? But now it's so homogenized. It's all the same, you know? Good afternoon, everybody. If you'd like to talk about what you're doing today, just reach me on the call center at 888-555-RADIO right now. There's no personality anymore. Thank you very much for the comment. That's nice, yeah. Jeff, I remember the Loop when I was a kid. Very, very, yeah, legendary station. It was fun. This was a fun shirt to get. I was grateful to get it. Dave, Temecula, California is here. Whiskey 6, Charlie Romeo Tango, celebrating the Rams win, I bet. Yep, that's good. And yes, indeed, happy birthday to Ishmael, 18 years old today. Second trivia question. Okay, listen carefully. There is no difference between the orbits of geosynchronous and geostationary satellites, okay? Listen carefully. There is no difference between the orbits of geosynchronous and geostationary satellites. A is true. B is false. Let me know your answer to this question, and we'll get to the answer of the final score for today. Again, geostationary versus geosynchronous orbits. Are they the same? A is true. B is false. Let's see what we got from around the world, and hopefully we'll find out who wins first. Right now, a tie score, by the way. Really cool. World and North America are tied. We always do this way because, you know, there's so many North America questions, especially U.S. related. So it's kind of the world against North America. Yeah. And Alan Webb, welcome. It's nice to have you. Uses an FT-847. Nice rig. That's a nice rig. Beautiful rig. Really is. And Billy, that's sweet. Yeah, happy 18th birthday to Ishmael. Yeah, we want to wish him the very best. He's having a special day today. Really, he's going to a nice restaurant, a 5-star hotel. He said yesterday. Also getting another antenna for his 10-meter band stuff. Radio Man, thank you. That means a lot. Great show. Thank you so much. That's November 9, Romeo Whiskey. Thank you. That's very humbling to me. Thank you very, very much. Rod Clare, Salem, Oregon. First one in. He did this twice. Look at this. He has B. And the answer is B, false. North America takes the lead, 80-75. Woohoo! Okay. It's a big game this week, this month. We're close. Yeah, there is a difference between geosynchronous and geostationary satellites. Let's take a look. Geosynchronous orbits, think of them as they travel around the Earth, not at the equator. Okay, a geostationary orbit is the one that orbits at the equator. That's the difference between the two of them. So, while they both stay in the same place, they don't stay over the equator. One does, one doesn't. Congratulations to my dear friend, Rod Clare. Salem, Oregon, get it right. Jeff also in Tennessee had that. Plasma Storm, November 5, Echo Victor Victor. Brand new call sign. Gone are the days of the Wolfman Jack and all the great disc jockeys. You know, there's still one left, I think. Broadway Bill Lee. Listen to him afternoons on WCBS New York. He is that kind of guy. He's been in radio for now 50 years. He has that old style. He's really good to listen to. WCBS, he's there 2 to 6 p.m. Eastern. Listen to him, William. He's phenomenal. He's old school. Thankfully, he's still around. Andy Kelly had B. Martin's is 18, so was a long time ago.
No!
I know. Billy with B. William had A. Mike Oswald answers with F. Thank you very much for that, Mike. Steve with A, Andy with B, Ron had B, and Kiel wishes him happy birthday to Ishmael. That's pretty sweet. Martin in the Netherlands had B, Anton in Holland also with B. That's pretty cool. And yes, we give a lot of congratulations to people who license up. If you do license up, please let us know on the show. We'd like to be able to celebrate you, okay? This is Tell Me Something Good Tuesday. It really is. We're going to talk about things that you're happy about in ham radio. Maybe something you just accomplished, right? Could be something that maybe you did that you're really proud of. Could be something maybe you learned. Let's talk about today on Tell Me Something Good Tuesday.
Tell me something good.
And we'll add it to today's show. That's what we're going to do. We're going to head down south, not just to like South Africa or, you know, Antarctica. We're going to go in the middle of the ice fields. We're going to go all the way to Antarctica. What it's like to live there. What it's like to work there. Let's first take a look at a really good video, and I'll have all the links in the description of this show. This is what it's like to work at Scott Base, which is a New Zealand base, which is run there in Antarctica, and it's the comms base. So I hope you enjoy this part of the show. It's really neat thinking about living in Antarctica and what it's like. By the way, they also get crank calls.
This is the communications room. This is the communications room at Scott Base. So this is the heart of Scott Base, we like to think of it. So we've got 4 communications operators that work here on a 24-hour day rota. And we take all of the phone calls, the emails, and the radio calls into Scott Base, and we're responsible for ensuring all of the safety of the field parties. So we've got 2 different types of radio communication. We've got very high frequency, which is our normal radio, and we've got high frequency, which is our long distance radio. And then we've got the telephone, and we have a satellite telephone link as well, and we have email. Signing in and out of base is our way of finding out where everybody is in the local area, and also it gives us a time frame, so if people don't come back at the right times, we can start a search and rescue. Say if you'd fallen down a crevasse and nobody knew you were going to come home. But my pet hate is when people don't sign out, or when they don't come back in before they sign out time. You can always extend your time, but if you're late, we all start to get a little bit panicky and think you've been eaten by zombie penguins. When you're talking on the radio, make sure that you press the button and then speak. Try and speak in a natural rhythm and pitch, so you don't have to yell into the radio. And also don't be afraid, you know, we're real friendly people and we care about the people we're talking to, so you just have to talk to us as if you're going to have a conversation.
Hello, K242,
this is Scott Base, go ahead.
Just crossing out on
all of the communications operators come from the New Zealand military. Obviously, we've never met each other before. We apply for the job in competition, so just like everybody else here. And although we're military, we work as if this was our civilian environment, so we don't really go by rank. But sometimes you'll see us in uniform, which can be a little bit of a shock when people forget because they see us in our normal clothes on a day-to-day basis.
So not all of the phone calls that we get at Scott Base are business calls. Occasionally we get some joke calls, and sometimes we just get members of the public calling up to find out if there are any polar bears or if there are penguins, or sometimes just if it's cold. So this is our latest crank call that ended up on our answer phone.
Friday, 3:40 a.m.
Yeah, how are you going? I'm wanting to buy a polar bear, and a friend of mine told me that this is the number to ring. I don't want to spend any more than 5,000. You know, I want one of those. Excuse me. I'm trying to buy a polar bear, and you guys have Sunday ketchup.
How much?
You're not going to buy a box of chocolates and buy a polar bear. Yes, sir, sorry about that. I apologize. So what I want to do is buy this polar bear, and I'll look after it.
There you go. A little bit of a prank call. And what it's like to work comms from Scott Base. Let's take a look from outside in. We're going to go out far. Okay, this is Antarctica. If we were to take a look at the entire continent, okay? As we zoom in towards Scott Base, there it is in relationship to New Zealand, Tasmania, and Australia. Go a little closer, and here's how we take a look. There it is. Scott Base. It's right just by McMurdo Station. They're very close, okay? In a far-out version, here it is right there. You see a lot of ice and snow. Of course, it's Antarctica. Closer in, there it is. And the road is only open during the summer months. That's the honest truth. So this is where they're working from. And they have to handle their own problems, plus fix things on the go. Take a look at this. This is a great video that was done. This is Victor Kilo Zero, Papa Delta. Paul from VK Land, Australia. And we have a sign up from there today to honor Australia and the work that he did there. Here he is talking about what it's like to work ham radio all the way down in Antarctica.
We'd like to hand over to Paul, VK0PD, who'll go through his journey down in Antarctica. Yeah. Thank you, Paul.
Cheers, Hayden. Cheers, Hayden. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for inviting me along. It's really good to see some new faces after nearly a year down there with the same 27 people, or 26 others. A little bit about myself. I sort of was interested in radio since I was a kid. Was in the CBs and that when I was about 13 years old. And back then you had to do Morse, and I couldn't do that. I wasn't smart enough for Morse. So fast forward a couple of years, and I've done just about everything I've wanted to ever do. I went down to Antarctica for the first time and found out about radio, and went down for the second time and had some chats with some electronics engineers and found out that they dropped the requirement for Morse, and tried to get my foundation before I went in 16, 17. And I think that's when I first came here and I met Justin and maybe a few other people here. And that didn't happen for me. Couldn't organise an exam before I went. So I went back down, and as soon as I got back, I went and did my foundation, and since then I've upgraded to advanced. So I've been down three times to Antarctica now. In 2015, I summited at Casey Station. In 2016-17, I summited and wintered at Davis. And this past year, I've wintered at Casey again. So it's been a pretty awesome experience to be able to go and do that kind of stuff. And luckily, I managed to squirrel my way into getting an operator radio down there. So I've got a couple of photos I've put together, just grabbed off the phone and whatnot. I would have liked to have done something a bit better, but when Hayden got on to me about it, is right in the time where things there turn into a nightmare when you get all the new people and it's busy. So unfortunately, this is all I've got. But my trades, I'm an industrial electrician by trade and also an instrument technician. So I've got two trades, And this year I was also what they call the building services supervisor, who's sort of in charge of all the tradespeople down there, so plumbers, carpenters and whatnot, and also the deputy station leader. So I was second in charge there for a while. So yeah, the photo here shows Casey. I'm not sure how many people are familiar, I know a few of you are. This section up here is where we live, this big red building, called the Red Shed. Down there is sort of, this was the old station area, and we've still got quite a few buildings. We've got a wharf and a fuel tank down there, and you can see that's a photo in the summer where they've got the road cut through. So the first thing I did when I got to Casey was I did a bit of a site survey, because I'd spoken to Kim Briggs before I went down to sort of get the lowdown on where I could operate down there, and he gave me a few suggestions. And when I got there, I was pretty blown away by how bad the noise was. Some really serious noise. So I ended up, I tried down there, I tried out here, and I ended up just here. So hopefully this works. So this is a view from Casey from back down towards the water looking up. This is an older photo, so there's a new section of building here now called the East Wing. That's where we live. And just there, there's a little shack that I operated from called the Hobby Hut. So Casey's a pretty nice sort of weather place. We don't get really cold. We get maximums of about minus 30, minus 35. So in Antarctic terms, it's pretty tame weather. I think our top wind speed this year was 117 knots. So yeah, other stations get it worse. It was far colder when I was at Davis. So here's a photo of just, I threw the 705 on because it was easier to move around. And this is the kind of noise, 20 metres and up was pretty good. Anything below 20 metres started to get a bit noisy, but you've got all these little birdies everywhere. And later in my season, I did track down where they came from. I made a little mag loop and did a bit of direction finding like a real nerd does. And got some really weird looks from all the other people with me walking down the street with a mag loop. But it turned out to be some speed controllers on our generators were faulty and we didn't have spares. So unfortunately, I couldn't swap them out. But yeah, that was the typical sort of operating environment I'd work in. And the killer was when you'd speak to someone and you'd had to QSY to a different frequency for whatever reason, they'd always seem to pick one of these birdies. And in hindsight, I should have been smart enough to write down the no-go frequency zones, but I didn't learn that lesson until like September. So probably a little bit slow off the mark there. And just if you've got any questions too, feel free to jump in. So this was my my humble little setup initially. It looks really, really neat, and it stayed really, really neat for a whole of about 10 minutes. So you can see there, I've got my modified little old computer ATX power supply and a giant linear power supply I pulled out of a repeater at home. So I'm running a HLA 300, or HLA 305 amp there from RM Italy. And that was a bit of a power pig. So it took everything that linear power supply had to offer. And I only needed to do about 35 watts drive out of the ICOM to get 400 watts out. So the little ATX power supply worked quite well. The building I'm working out of here is called the Hobby Hut. So the idea behind the Hobby Hut is most of your people on station are like me. They're tradies, got a good background in machinery and whatever. So we've got our own workshops. We can go between the different workshops and do whatever we want, our little projects or whatever. But you get scientists down, you get operations people down, and it's just too high a risk having them in a full-size workshop. So they've got this building set aside. The big advantage with the Hobby Hut is in wintertime, we're all tradies pretty much. So we use our main workshop and this place is just derelict. So I set up in here, had a phone working later on. We couldn't get the phone working early in the season, which is a whole other issue. But it was pretty close to the Red Shed. So if I go back, too far. So yeah, that's where I lived and it was just over there. So it was literally like 100 metres walk away. So it was quite convenient to get to for me. So I did pretty much all of my operating from there and I learned a really valuable lesson early on. When you're doing a lot of contacts, you can't use a hand mic because you just get cramps. Like I don't really think I'm weak, but just pressing that button over and over and over and holding it, it just wears you down. So in a second, I'll have a beautiful foot switch coming up. This is what it generally looked like. Everything's shoved back at the moment because the roof above me leaks. So a really important factor in Antarctica is you can have one or two things. You can have a warm building, you can have a dry building, but you can't have both. So we have warm buildings, and what happens is you get snow lands on the roof, the sun hits the roof, heats the roof expands and contracts, the snow melts, goes down between all the joins, and tends to drip right on your really expensive laptop and radio, which I found out the hard way, but luckily nothing was damaged. So I had quite a good setup here. I grabbed that little old oscilloscope, little Tektronix unit from my workshop. We had a couple of those there. And I spent quite a bit of time just doing some experiments. I had spectrum analyzers out to check my amplifier for linearity and whatnot. And I can comment on those amps now and say they are a really clean output at 400.
And, you know, I'm going to have to cut a little bit because I'm going to have to get going in a few minutes. But what he did was he found that holding the hand mic for so long, you're in Antarctica, man. That's everybody's trying to work you, right? So you've got to constantly be hitting the key, hitting the key, hitting the key, hitting the key. Anyway, he found that he got sore from doing that. So he created a foot switch, a two-piece of plywood, a relay that he found just lying around someplace, and a spring with a door hinge. I mean, they just literally use whatever they can to make it work. And yes, the foot switch is still in Antarctica. Let's find out about Paul's antenna and what happened to it. This is what happens when the weather gets bad in Antarctica.
So back in Australia, you guys get weather forecasts, so you know what the weather's going to be. And we get weather forecasts in the summer when we've got a full-time forecaster down there. In the wintertime, we get this thing called an ensemble. And so this is how I get to predict what the weather's going to be and whether or not...
Sorry about this. This is my brother's phone. Bear with me. It's just a little bit of problem here, so we're going to move forward. And I'm just going to give you an idea of what happened to his antenna, because just because of timing, okay? So let's talk about this. A little bit of a storm hit, and he didn't get his antenna down in time. But let's take a look as he explains things.
Zone of death. So 50 knots is suddenly 80, 90, 100 knots. And I made the mistake a few times of relying on the accuracy of these things. And you can go to the time here, and you can go, oh, it... 12 UTC on the 22nd, it's picking up. So I'll make sure my antenna's down by that time. But sometimes this whole hump shifts this way considerably. And I made that mistake a few too many times. And it ended up resulting in me being off air for about 2 months just because it broke me. Like, you can only rebuild antennas down there so many times before you just get disheartened. So after losing a few antennas, I thought, well, it'd be a great idea, instead of packing the antenna away, to just lower the antenna to the ground and just tie it off. And stupid me didn't realize that if you get a lot of snow at the same time as you get wind, everything blizzes up and you get these big blizz tails, as we call them, and they all appear downwind of an obstruction. And seeing my radio operating location is downwind of the biggest building on station, there's about a 4 meter berm of snow here. So my antenna... was maybe anywhere from a meter to 2 meters under there for the entire length of one side of the fan. So that took me about 7 hours to dig out without destroying the antenna. Good lesson learnt there. So this one is another example. This is the snow berm that I was talking about. So if you look in the sort of the top right-hand side of the picture, you can see the yellow building. I don't think this has come back to life, has it? Oh, it has. Whoa, there you go. So you can see that building there. My hut's just here. So these are the guy ropes for my antenna. And I had a look at that ensemble, and I'm like, yep, Saturday afternoon, the wind's going to come up. It was Thursday night. I'm like, I'll just leave the antenna up tonight. I'll go and operate tomorrow morning, and then I'll pack it away. Well, I woke up tomorrow morning, and it was already 45 knots, and I can't lower the antenna in 45 knots. And from there, it proceeded to 117 knots. So that little tangle there is what was left of my 40, 30, 20, and 17 meter fan dipole. And that was the end of my operating for the 2 months. So that was really, really, that was a killer for me. And it's hard to explain down there because the fact that in the wintertime you don't get the sunlight, it really messes with your motivation and your energy levels. So we were getting maybe an hour a day of sunlight in the middle of winter, and you go home from work feeling just absolutely destroyed. Like, you're so tired, and it's like 4:30, 5 o'clock in the arvo. So when your antenna breaks, you don't have the motivation to go down the workshop and rebuild it again. And after I'd lost about four antennas, I'd had enough. I'd snapped a couple of fiberglass squid poles at that stage, and I thought, I'm going to take a break. So conditions weren't ideal. It was really cold every day. Then it was minus 25, minus 30, and even the shack was at like 1 degree, because it's not built for habitation in winter.
There you go. That is some serious work of what it's like to live in Australia and work a ham radio. Everything matters. The wind and the forecast, those are key. But also being ingenious, right? Look at how ingenious Paul was. Thank you for the great video. The description for the link will be in below, please. And look at it. It's really good. What they did in that interview was so well done, and I can only show you a little bit of it just for time, but I'll tell you, it's really, really worth watching. I want to encourage you today, please, put your radio on. Look at the current MUFs out there. That's fantastic. And this now stretches almost to Alaska for 12 meters, and people all through Canada now are pretty close to 10. You're going to work all the way to South America, into the South Pacific, and within a couple of hours, you're going to hit Australia. It's a great day to turn your ham radio on. Please use your radio. Have some fun today. You'll enjoy it. We're going to end the show. I have to, because I've got to be about 25 miles away in 31 minutes. We'll get there. Thank you for coming, everybody. I'm sorry I can't welcome everybody, Tom and Jeff and everyone else here. Thank you for coming from around the world. Charlie from Red Summit, it's an honor to see you again. For the folks that come, it means a lot. It really does. I do this to have fun, but to give back. The whole goal is to give back to you. And I really want you guys not only to get your license, but also license up. And then we're going to celebrate like heck, okay? Please contact a radio club to help you find a local club. They can help you get your license. Pretty simple. Try someone today. Why don't we go with somebody we haven't went with for a while? Let's try that. Let's go with, we did Radio Amateur Canada yesterday. Let's go with, I guess we haven't done the ARL for a while, so we could do them. They're kind of local to us here. The American Radio Relay League. You can find them at www.arl.org. www.arl.org. Hit the contact us part. Let them know where you're located, and they'll find a ham radio club close to you that can help you get your license or license up. Don't be satisfied unless you've licensed up as high as you can, because you're going to get everything you deserve. Power, frequencies, and more fun. God bless you guys. Have a wonderful Tuesday, wherever you may be. And it's an honor to meet you today. Thanks for watching Ham Radio Live. Till we meet again, God bless you and goodbye, everybody.
Time for us to say goodnight from ABC Television, from all of us, that is, each and every little one of us. Tomorrow night at 25 to 9, top comedy on ABC Television with Don't Wait Up. Let me explain briefly for you what we expect to happen. Well, you see, Toby has moved into Tom's flat and is not proving the easiest of guests. Well, when Toby goes out for the evening, Tom invites his mother round and offers her Toby's bed, as she has had a bit too much to drink. Fair enough. Toby also returns with a guest for the night. Not so fair enough. The embarrassing situation is not discovered until the following morning. And you'll have to wait till tomorrow night at 25 to 9 to discover what they discover. Once again, good night.